head talking down to you, it seems like I'm at a higher plane than you, but don't let that fool you, you know. We're all learning here and nobody's an expert. So that was a fascinating overview and introduction, and I think you painted a great picture of where the world is headed. But I'm actually going to pick out and really focus on the last thing you said, which I think is very resonant with the way I'm thinking about this topic, and that is the customer experience is the true north. I think that's a great way to think about it. That's a great way for you to think about your business. It's a great way for your clients to think about their business, because this word disruption, you know, gets talked about. It seems negative, right? It's like something's being broken up or something's being destroyed. But actually, disruption is beautiful because what's being created is better customer experiences. So that's the way I'm going to frame this discussion of disruption. It's a win for the customer. I mean, it messes up enterprises, of course. But let's think about sort of the positive aspect of it. And then I think that's where I'm going to begin and then talk about how do we respond. Because at the end of the day, as you pointed out, Raj, that these changes are exponentiating. And I think they're exponentiating because technologies don't build on each other's additively. They build on each other multiplicatively. So, and this is not new. It pays to remember that when Edison started the Edison Electric Company, you know, he just didn't build the light bulb. He figured out how to distribute electricity. And the way where did they put the electric wires? They put them inside gas pipes. I still have one. My house was built in 1894. And I was looking in my attic the other day, and I had a cloth-wrapped electric wire light. And it was actually a gas lamp. And the wire was, that's an interesting combination, a cloth-wrapped electric wire inside a gas lamp, you know. But that's, so basically, and how did we get the internet in our homes? It came over phone lines. It came over cable. And it goes way back. Where was the telegraph laid? It was laid next to the railroads. So technologies build on each other. Now all this critical mass is suddenly exploding. So the pace of change is only going to accelerate. It is mind-boggling to sort of think that the iPhone is Facebook. These are all decade-old phenomena, and we have become such a part of our fabric. So it's sometimes dizzying, and I've been in this business now 25 years, and it's just sort of, you keep having to sort of pause and check yourself and say, wow, that was fast. And I'm going to share with you towards the end of my presentation some recent data on the pace at which this digital adoption is happening in India, where I am on the board of the company that's actually driving a lot of the telecom infrastructure transformation. And just a quick, we just got the number yesterday. I'm going for the board meeting next week. We launched 26 days ago, and we have 16 million subscribers. Right? We're adding 1 million people a day. And AT&T activating 1 million customers a day. I think last time I looked, they gained maybe 2 million subscribers over a quarter. So we're going to hit 150 million subscribers in. We thought it was 18 months. It's going to be 6 months. The average data consumption on this network, which is a 4G LTE-only network, is 30 gig per subscriber. Try buying that here. All for about $2 a month or $4 a month. So you have to sort of sit back and say, is this real? Is this the speed at which this transformation is happening? So yes, it is very real. So let's start with what disruption is. And again, I'm going to take a very simplistic view of this. But sometimes simplicity is good. We've learned that in politics too. You know, you overcomplicate things, people don't. The average intelligence of the voter, never underestimate the stupidity of the voter. So, you know, keep it simple. And then if it's, you know, cerebral stuff is not good for, anyway, you know. Don't get me started with Brexit and Colombia and FARC and, you know, and Trump and so on and so forth. But anyway, so here's my simplistic way of thinking about what digital disruption is. That what we're doing is we're using a toolkit. And by the way, this toolkit now is increasingly a Lego block toolkit. You know, a 13-year-old kid can build an app because he didn't have to create a proximity sensor, a GPS device, and, you know, and a display and an operating system and so on. It's all there. All you need is an idea and relentless execution. You know, the platforms are there. The critical mass is there. It is funny. I've been in this business long enough to remember that a lot of the same ideas that were tried 20 years ago are now reinventing themselves. And I remember a company called OmniSky that had a data back that they put on a Palm 7 that used to help you find restaurants and so on. It was iOS 20 years ago, except the network wasn't there, the battery life wasn't there, the displays weren't there. So we're seeing the reemergence. Remember WebVan, Cosmo? You know, they're coming back now as, you know, Amazon Prime Now. So the critical mass is there, and it's worldwide. The network is global. Everybody is connected. In the beginning of in January of this year, the number of mobile connections surpassed the world population. There are more mobile connections now than there are people on the planet. Man, woman, child, everywhere, and 7.5 billion connections. So we're using this technology to deliver superior customer value. So disruption is meaningless unless somebody pays for it, right? At the end of the day, the metric for disruption has to be disruption in the customer experience in a positive way. And this is actually Andy Grove talked about disruption in this context. There's a figure of merit that changes 10x somewhere. Whether it's price, it's convenience, it's something. Some experience metric significantly changes. The customer then says, this is disruptive. I mean, if you look at your experience that you have with Uber, and you compare that with the experience you used to have with the yellow cab, it is an order of magnitude better. That's why it's disruptive. That's why people will pay for it. That's why they will adopt it. So let's not think about disruption from products that we're going to make and the process. At the end of the day, think about the customer experience and the customer value. And that is really, and then the way we do disruption, the mechanisms are either you're changing the product, or you're changing the go-to-market, or you're changing the business model, or you're creating marketplaces and efficiencies, or you're creating better UX and UI user experiences. So three elements in this definition. One, what is the toolkit? It is the digital technologies, now includes AI, machine learning, all this other stuff. You know, mobile. Mobile is a big driver of it. That's the toolkit. What are the mechanisms by which we use that toolkit? It is we apply it to domains like products, channel, and so on. And what is the outcome? Superior customer value. That's a very simple way of thinking about digital disruption. You know, we make it too complicated sometimes. And then as you think about the customer value proposition, again, you know, I can boil it down to these six C's that these generally describe the way value propositions are visualized by customers. Choice. You know, if you look at what e-commerce did for us, it just exploded the amount of choice that we have, Amazon and so on and so forth. Cost. By cutting middlemen out, by creating marketplace efficiencies. Uber is also cheaper than taxis, right? Convenience, you know, the ability to have stuff 7x24. In fact, the AI assistant application you're talking about, it's about the fact that now I have 7x24. I used to have a broker who I could call 8 to 5, and their voicemail said, please don't leave instructions for trade. You know, and then I can't get a hold of him for 3 days to place a trade, but now I have an app, you know, I have convenience, I have 7x24 access. This convenience is going to greatly impact healthcare. You know, think about experiences that suck. I mean, if you look at doctor's visits, if you look at it was a cab experience, you know, there's so many things that suck today. So we want 7x24 access, you know. So that's the education is a big one, by the way, control. The feeling that I am driving it. This is what's driving healthcare now, consumer-directed healthcare. I am in control. I want to drive this process. The doctor is no longer God, you know, and I feel also that when I am driving the experience at Uber or with my broker or with my, you know, that I am in control. That's a big customization, the ability to personalize and customize the experiences because now you have data that you can use. And the value of community, whether that takes the form of product reviews or, you know, bringing social, you know, intelligence into the purchasing decision. You know, there was a company called Bazaar Voice that did an interesting study a few years ago. And they found that on the same e-commerce site, same products, same prices, if you add reviews to all the products, sales go up by 45%. Because people just feel more confident. So that's the power, that's the proprietary asset that an Amazon has, which is this customer customer-generated review content. That's proprietary data, right? So those are the, so if you're going to look at benchmarking your customer experience vis-a-vis the disruptors, these are some things to think about, you know, and think about where you're vulnerable to attack. So let's take a quick look at a couple of things. You know, I have a very simplistic view of this. You put the word connected in front of anything, it gets transformed, right? Connected car, connected home, connected health, connected education. So let's take a look at a couple of, I visited this company in Shenzhen last year. I did a keynote for them. It's called Technogym. I don't know if any of you have ever used a Technogym machine. This is, you know, when the Italians make treadmills, they're $10,000. They look like a Lamborghini, and they're beautiful. So that's their Technogym device. But what is fascinating about this machine is it's not just a machine, it's a connected device. It's an Android device, and as you walk up to the machine, it reads from your band all your data. And it is able to combine. Imagine a world where your nutrition information, your EMR, your health information, and your fitness information was all put together to say the following. Hello, John. I know that you ate a donut yesterday, so 2 more miles today on the treadmill. By the way, I'm going to make sure you run at a pace where your heart rate doesn't go up over 120 beats because I know you have a heart condition. And, and would you like to run the same route you ran yesterday outside? Because I can in 3D simulate the exact same route and run at the same space with the same. That's what they're able to do with the Wellness Cloud. So the Wellness Cloud pulls together data from your fitness trackers, pulls together, you know, it reads all the apps if you're using MapMyRun or other sorts of applications. And it creates an experience for you that is personalized. So that's custom. Now, by the way, for the gym operator, they're able to now look at the data on who's using what machines, what workouts they are doing, and they are using this, so they have an application for the facility operators to be able to create virtual coaching programs and personal fitness to complement the machine workouts. And they're also able to optimize the facility usage by seeing which, you know, what are the traffic patterns, because now I have telemetry on each machine. So that's, you know, so the visit to the gym will never be the same. You know, so that's connected fitness. You know, connected cars, of course, I own a Tesla, and, you know, it was very creepy, 70 miles an hour, you're going around a bend, I'm like, is it going to work, is it not going to work? And what was fascinating is that it is not only the fact that, by the way, Tesla is not an electric car. The really important thing is this software on wheels. It's really an iPad on wheels. It's a different paradigm. To give you one example of a use case, I was driving the car in December, and I'm like, why is the power consumption more than its rated consumption? Because it tells you, you know, your rated range is 250. I'm only getting 180. So I make a phone call. I'm driving on the highway. I make a phone call to the Tesla people. And so he says, what's the problem? I said, you know, my power consumption seems to be higher. He says, I'm pulling up your diagnostics on your car. And he said, I'm going to benchmark it with all the cars within a 20-mile radius of where you live. And he said, I'm looking at the stats. It all looks good. You're within the range, but I noticed that you're doing cold starts. So it's cold in Chicago. What you need to do is use the app 5 minutes before you start the car. There are 5 heaters in the battery. You need to get those things. Otherwise, it consumes a lot of power. Thank you. Goodbye. So the car is basically providing diagnostics in real time. When I first started the autopilot, I noticed something interesting. When you take a sharp turn in the highway, it was doing piecewise linear turns. So the car would kind of turn. And what happens is that you panic and you hit the brake. 60,000 cars are transmitting data in real time about what's going on. So, you know, an algorithm detects that when curve radius is greater than 45 degrees, there are a lot of off-autopilot events happening for course correction. Aha, linear, piecewise linear smoothing happens, and the update is downloaded the next day, and now my car turns smoothly. So that's the new paradigm, right? So essentially, the intelligence has moved from the hardware to the software, and through instrumentation and sensors, you basically made the car a connected appliance. And that's sort of the paradigm shift here. So the car is now really a cloud and mobile appliance. So it's not just the idea that it's an autopilot. It's this notion there that software eats everything, as Andreessen says. Software ate the car, right? So that's kind of what's happening. So that's sort of what disruption is about. Now, what I find helpful is And one of the things that we do as academics is to try and come up with structure, you know, sort of structure the landscape. And what I'm going to do is share with you some archetypical designs of disruption. There are patterns. So as I look at the landscape, you know, I've organized these patterns into three or four categories, and I've given them names so that you can hang your hat on them. Because each of these designs is a particular pattern of disruption, and I have some diagnostic questions that will tell you, are you susceptible to that form of disruptors? So these are species, right? So the species that I'm finding is that the way I look at it is that disruption is happening either at the marketplace level, right? So it's market disruption, which is actually a disruption between supply, demand, and actors in the marketplace. I call that Uberizing. Or disruption is happening to the product and the structure of the product and the way the product is consumed and accessed. That is serviceization. You know, and all the SaaS stuff and all fits in here. And the third kind of disruption, which is the oldest disruption that we know of, is the disruption in the go-to-market and how customers access your products and services. And that's channel disruption. That's Amazonization. So these are these are conceptually different. And different industries and sectors are susceptible to this form of disruption in different ways. So let's look at these. So the marketplace disruption or Uberization takes place in two ways. You either have an asset or you have a labor resource that is underutilized, or there is latent supply available in the marketplace. Uber didn't take cabs and, you know, connect people to cabs. It brought latent supply into the marketplace. Same thing in labor marketplaces. One of my students started a company called Culture Alley, and what he does is that he connects you to people in India. Like, my kid learns Punjabi from a woman who's in India, puts her kids to bed at night, and that's morning here, and she teaches them. So she's an underutilized or underemployed person. So whether it's a labor asset or a capital asset, and if you look, you have to just look around. You know what VMware did to, and their insight was that server utilization was 15%. I mean, how often is your car used? I was with Cessna a few months ago, and I fell off my chair when they told me that the average utilization for a Cessna Citation jet that is owned by privately is 0.6 hours a day. So we are sitting at 90 to 95% waste factors in terms of capacity utilization. So this means that now we can bring this, and some of this supply is latent. I did not know I had a room in my house that I could monetize. That's latent supply. So Airbnb comes along and says, hey, you want to make some money? You know, or my car sitting in my garage, do you want to like rent it out? Like, I'm not traveling for 2 weeks. I got two nice cars sitting in my garage. I could be making some money. So that's the idea, that there are underutilized assets and labor, latent supply, and usually it's orchestrating a network without owning assets. This is an asset-light model because you're just basically connecting supply and demand. And it also taps into this whole trend of ownership versus access, because, you know, now what we're saying is that the millennials and the youngsters, they don't want to own anything. I cannot get my 21-year-old daughter to get a driver's license. She's like, why? And she actually had a whole TCO conversation with me. And I said, it makes a ton of sense, because I said, your Uber bill is about $75 a month. And I was like, and I checked with the insurance company, if I add her as a driver, just that is $2,000 a year, incremental on my insurance. I said, please do Uber. And I have to buy a car, which she will crash if she buy, you know, kids will crash the car, there's depreciation, there's insurance, there's parking, by the way, parking in Chicago will cost you $75 an hour. She goes to Northwestern. So $75 a month, she'll just be spending on parking. So I said, please go, glory to never get a driver's license. I'm never getting you a car. So that's the idea. And I think we haven't seen the beginning yet. I think when you talk to the founders of Uber, it's not about car sharing or ride sharing. It's about redefining urban living. It's really about redefining the whole, you can liberate up hundreds of football fields worth of real estate in Manhattan and San Francisco and build and generate real estate because you're getting rid of parking lots. There was a very interesting study that I saw recently that it said that how you could drive down real estate rents in cities by about 10%. simply by liberating the parking lots that are needed. And the other thing is that about 30% of the fuel or spent in Manhattan is cars looking for parking. So this is these are implications go well beyond getting a cab to the airport. This is about sort of redefining the economics of ownership versus access. So this is happening all over the place. The one that I was working with Caterpillar recently, and they made an investment in, it's a Bay Area company, Yard Club, Uber for excavators, right, $500,000 machine that is used 10%. I mean, think about that. It's obvious economics. Private jets, JetSmarter. You know, this is a company, I actually bought the subscription. It's like 9,000 bucks a year and unlimited private jet flights, including scheduled flights that go. So you can come to, you know, Chicago to LA, Chicago to Miami, Chicago to New York twice a week. They fly scheduled flights on a Gulfstream, you know. So it's all you can eat for $9,000 a year. Makes a ton of sense to me. And then you know, you can get the empty legs for free in addition. Boats. Then these are assets. Then there are labor marketplaces, doctors, logo and web designs. I love this, you know, you want a lawyer for an hour. It's like you want a gallon of milk. You don't want the dairy farm. You don't want the cow, right? You don't want a big law firm. You just need some attention to a specific matter. So this is happening. So Uberization is a concept. So what are the sort of vulnerability factors here? One, ask yourself, are you selling a high-value asset or high-value human capital? Further, is this capital asset or human asset utilized only part of the time, and there is significant spare capacity? And is this an asset that your customers need only occasionally and not day in and day out? Right. So if those conditions are, and therefore, is there latent capacity in your marketplace that can be brought online? So these are the sort of diagnostic factors that will tell you that this is subject to Uberization. You know, I actually implemented this. I was just telling Raj, I was at Cisco in February, and I was doing a telepresence call with their CMO, Karen Walker. So I said, you know, you guys have these telepresence rooms, beautiful rooms. How many of these do you have? They said, we have them in 100 cities around the world. The light bulb goes on in my head, Uber for telepresence. So I said, why don't we do executive education and leverage your infrastructure? So we're going to do this kind of program, high-value executive education, and we'll do it worldwide. The deal is I give you 2 seats out of 10. You can bring your clients in, or you can bring whatever, and we'll bring the rest. We pay you nothing for the infrastructure. It's completely flexible. And so they signed on. And I'm happy to announce that we've just launched the 2016 Alumni Competitive Edge Series. We're running it in 8 cities. The first session was on October 5th. The second session is happening today. And the next, we're going to roll it out worldwide. Cost to us, zero. We're using spare capacity that they have. And by the way, we found that, oh, people didn't sign up in Seattle. We're going to kill Seattle. We're going to do New York. And here, our friends at the Harvard Business School have spent $30 million to create a studio that still, what's silly is that the great experience that it creates is for the instructor, because you have a wall of 60 TV screens where you can see all the participants. You know what the other endpoint is? WebEx. Like, the instructor has a fantastic experience. The students have a lousy experience. So I'm like, good for you. Our CapEx is zero. So just think along those lines. I think that so we save T&E and so on and so forth. So and I've done the economics. We can make $500,000 a year on this offering with an 80% gross margin. And the faculty have to just walk across, spend 90 minutes to talk. So that's the thought process that you have to think about. The second thing is servicization. Right, so here, basically, what you do is you add intelligence to an asset. There was a very, very old statement by Carly Fiorina, and I think it makes a ton of sense. She said, if it can be connected to a wire, it's up for grabs. So any asset that can be instrumented and made more intelligent, you can then servicize it. Right? So this is the idea of servicization. And here, the product becomes a service delivery platform. You know, in the old, 10 years ago, Scott McNeely said, what is a car? It's a Java docking station on wheels, right? So it's really the servicization. So servicization is the idea. It's not, sometimes the product is completely converted into a service, like SaaS, but sometimes the value migrates to software, as in Tesla, right? The product hasn't been converted into software, but software is eating the value in the product. And that's going to happen to any instrumented asset, whether it's a medical diagnostic machine, mining equipment, You know, Raj and I was just talking that I was with a company called Wire Minerals. These guys make gigantic crushers and mining equipment for, you know, one of the pumps I saw was 170,000 pounds, 14 feet high, double-decker bus, and was used for the slurries in oil sands in Canada. So they were telling me, I said, what happens if this thing fails? He says, actually, we have over the last 20 years or 30 years of experience figured out the vibration patterns that start to tell us that this pump is likely to have an unscheduled maintenance event. By the way, the downtime cost is $1 million a day. So now the future there is mechatronics. It's running, trying to sort of put intelligence and sensors into those machines. And ultimately, you know, to push the thinking to the extreme, I give you the pump for free, you pay me for uptime. Because I'm not in the pump business, I'm in the uptime business. So different way of thinking about this idea. So sensors, instrumentation, just to sort of push your thinking here, GE lighting, right? So I have an example of this. So I met this woman who works for GE. So they have figured out how to put sensors in streetlights that detect gunshots. So now it turns out that, you know, if you want to shoot somebody, you have to see them, right? So it's like they ask Willie Sutton, why do you rob banks? So that's where the money is, or the drunk who was looking for his keys under a street light. I said, why are you looking here? Because he says, I have light here, so might be my keys are here. So basically, the idea would be that, only 1 out of 10 gunshots get reported in time for the police to reach. So the notion here is that these street lights would alert and give a location and send out and tell the police that there's a gun. So I could see cities paying for a crime monitoring and surveillance service. By the way, you get the light for free, right? So the light becomes a, so that's the tire. I was talking to an executive at Michelin. So I said, have you thought about tire as a service? He said, are you out of your mind? It's like, you know, I can't do software and tires. I said, well, think about it. You can now instrument the tires, because you all know that, you know, in a commercial fleet, if your tire is underinflated, you can lose 10 to 15% of fuel efficiency. So if you instrument the tires to monitor wear and to monitor tire pressure, initially only for commercial fleets, you can tell the customer, don't buy my tire, subscribe to my tire. Right? I'm going to charge you $25 a month per tire. I'm going to manage the repair, the installation, and by the way, I'll do predictive maintenance and tell you when it's to be inflated or underinflated. So it becomes a subscription idea. Right? So of course, we know SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. UAVs, Textron, which is in the defense business, I was talking to them. They have actually done this deal with the military. What these drones do is they are doing surveillance on targets in Iraq, Syria, wherever. They are getting paid, and they've actually negotiated this deal with the DoD. They're getting paid for pixels over target. Because how many pixels you send me of surveillance on a specified target? I pay you by pixels over target. I don't want to buy a drone or whatever it is. I pay you for the imagery. Right, and I pay you for the imagery that is over target. I don't want to pay you for imagery that's not on target. So that's the idea. Ag equipment. If you're John Deere and your market share is 70% and people aren't buying any more combines because fields are consolidating and machines are working better, what do? Ag management services. So these machines are now hooked up through GPS and their, you know, onboard diagnostic system. The operator at John Deere can take control of the machine, run diagnostics on it, combine this with geosensing data to tell you what your fertilizer should be, you know, nnitrogen here, no nitrogen there, phosphorus here, no phosphorus there, because they're looking at how much nutrient was removed by the previous crop. Tilling can be done with GPS location, so I can bring my crop rows down from 24 inches to 18 inches. That's direct 25% increase in productivity of the field. So basically what John Deere is saying in the ag management services, we don't sell combines, we don't sell equipment, we sell yield. But the general idea in all of this is sell an outcome. Sell an outcome, sell a service, sell something that, don't sell a product, because at the end of the day, what the customer wants to buy here is an outcome, right? So services are closer to outcome than products. That's an important thought. So that's the serviceization. So who's subject to this? Can your product be infused with software-based intelligence? By the way, everything pretty much can now. Your house, your car, your combine, your tractor, your tires, your electric lights, whatever it is, can be your mining equipment, industrial assets. Cisco's looking into this, the industrial internet, GE with Predix, so that's essentially everything can be now be connected to a network. And if can it be accessed over a network? Also, is there an opportunity for customers to pay you for what they use as opposed to paying for the product? So there's sort of pay-per-use, pay-as-you-go, pay-as-you-grow, value-based pricing, gain-sharing sorts of arrangements, right? So that's the second. Amazonization is perhaps the most familiar one for us, right? So here the idea is basically that if you've got middlemen, and if your middlemen are not adding value commensurate to the money that you give them, that you can start to, you can create efficiencies by eliminating the middleman. And also, the second aspect of this is that by having direct information about customers, that is a huge, data is a comparative advantage. I remember talking to Intel a few years ago. I said, what do you know about your end customer? They said two things. It has two legs and it owns a PC. Right? We have no information. Microsoft, same thing. 95% of sales go through partners. But now, Microsoft has telemetry. I mean, it's the first time you're like, shit, nobody uses this feature, right? And I remember talking to the guy who did media player, due apologies, people there from Microsoft are here. I worked with them for 15 years, know them well. So I said, how do you know people like media player? He said, I have 100% attach. Everybody buys media player. I said, yeah, if you give them a choice, ask them to pay even $2 for it, if you unbundle it, which Europe forced them to do. So much more accountability now, because you can start to see, and now, the culture is changing in the company. Things that you've never heard of, like DAO and MAO, are becoming KPIs that you worry about, daily average users, monthly average users, monitoring usage and consumption, as opposed to, here's your enterprise agreement, see you in 3 years. Good, have you deployed, don't deploy, not my problem. So can't do that anymore. So that's sort of the other thing. Data is a comparative advantage, right? So here's an unusual example. I met this fellow in Chicago. This is a Chicago-based startup, Opternative, right? Optical alternative, whatever. So what he does is you go to your PC and you open up the website and then and you open up the app. And he says, well, it asks you, what's your shoe size? And you say 12. He said, okay, start stepping 8 steps away from your computer. And now the app will ask you questions. What do you see? What do you see? And it's changing. It's doing an eye exam. And then the app says, okay, here's your prescription. Click here to buy. Completely eliminating the, now ophthalmologists love this guy, optometrists hate his guts. Because the optometrists, all they do is just change the lenses and say, what do you see, what do you see, what do you see? Stupid, completely can be automated, right? And he's done clinical trials where he shows that actually the human operator error is higher than what his algorithm does. So his results are superior. He had 3 optometrists on his advisory board, they got death threats. So they had to quit his advisory board because he's completely cut them out of the loop. So interesting idea, right? So credit cards in Brazil. This is my student, Christina. So the way credit cards, banks work, credit cards can only be gotten from banks in Brazil. You go to a bank physically to apply. They want to see your face. There's a big form. You get a statement once a month in the mail. Phone-based service is the only way to access service. Lots of hidden fees, and the interest rate, that's not a typo, it's 12% a month. So 100 to 150% APR. So she created this Platinum MasterCard. It is only issued over a smartphone. There's no other way you can get it. You can issue it over a smartphone, 100% digital channels for interaction. Her interest rate is still high because there's inflation there, but it's much lower. And the entire marketing is done by social media. So she's completely cut the so she's the new issuer. It's a MasterCard, and it has an Apple Watch app and so on and so forth. She tells me there's a waiting list of 2 million people. They don't want to, because they got to do the credit scoring. They don't want to just hand these things out. But massive disruption here, because the way that the customer experience, the channel experience is lousy, right? So that's something. So you think about here, very simple metric that what percentage of the category is going through e-commerce versus what percentage of your sales are going through e-commerce. You can see if you do these two numbers that Walmart has a problem. right? That they're $14 billion out of $400 billion, while e-commerce as a percentage is much higher, and Amazon, meanwhile, has built a $100 billion business. So, so that's the question. Also, look very hard at all the things that your channel does for you. Break it down. Deconstruct it into, you know, they do demand generation, they do customer service, they do installation, they do maintenance, they do warranty, they do advice, they do, you know, personalization, they do design. Break all those things down and then ask yourself, which of these things can be done electronically? So you may come up with a revised offering for your channel to say, I still need you, but I only need you to do installation. Or I only need you to do delivery, but I'm going to do demand generation myself. This is something, when I was working with Herman Miller, furniture company, many, many years ago, they saw an opportunity to use e-commerce. But what they found was that e-commerce allows them to open up their market to SMB, because they were traditionally only selling furniture to enterprises. So when they go to the SMB market, they were able to do that because I want a chair. I don't need a furniture solution for my office. You know, so startups and small companies were their target. So the dealer said, no, over our dead body, you're going to go direct. So they said, listen, guys, this is not your target audience anyway. You can't get these people. Plus, here's what I need you to do. I still need you to deliver and install. And you know what? I'm going to only pay you 10%. I'm going to pay you 30%. And by this 10% is new revenues for you because you're not getting this business. So they were able to overcome the channel conflict that way. So you really have to think through. By the way, I do think that at the end of the day, hybrid channels are the answer. You've seen Amazon's moves this way, and mark my words, in a couple of years, you will have 500 or 1,000 Amazon stores, physical stores. Just like you have Blue Nile opening up web rooms, 500 square foot jewelry out retail stores, no inventory. You come there, get your ring, get it sized, get it and all that. There's no diamonds there. You order it online. If I was to rebuild Walmart from scratch, if I was to rebuild retail stores from scratch, why the heck would I keep paper towels and diapers in the store? I would keep, store should become theater. Store should be entertainment. Store should be, you know, fresh produce and all those sorts of high value. The rest of the things should be auto replenishment that Amazon's doing with Dash and so on. So I think that the way, so retail will emerge into this sort of hybrid model. Same thing with banking. Citi's smart branches, 700 square feet, that's all you need. And if you need specialized advice, you go into a video room where you open up a video conference with a guy sitting in New York who could now advise you on private equity deals in the neighborhood, where I would not want this kind of specialized capability. So you're redefining the interaction that the customers have, and in an omni-channel design, you really have to think about what channel is going to do what function. It's a reallocation of functionality across channels. So how should we respond? All right. So there are four generic strategies that I want to talk about here, you know, and they are sort of in descending order of intestinal fortitude, right? So the most disruptive is to kill yourself, right? Disrupt yourself. But by the way, if you're going to be cannibalized, I say keep your cannibals in the family. You know, so it's best if you cannibalize yourself because so one is to disrupt yourself. The second is to actually, if you can't beat them, buy them, acquire a disruptor to kind of import that capability. The third thing is to like act like a disruptor, which is to adapt, and this includes the changes in the processes that you were talking about, agile, DevOps, and you know, changing the culture, and then absorb, which is to actually say, I'm going to actually digitize my enterprise. And I think that if you think about, Raj, the clients that you work with, you're probably doing all of these. And in fact, you as a company are also doing some of these, right? So let's look at these strategies in more detail. So attack is basically by saying that I actually have privileged assets that they don't have. So I can attack them asymmetrically using a judo strategy where I take my privileged assets and I attack them. For example, your Best Buy. Amazon's killing you, right? So I need to respond. I realize, wait, what does Amazon not have? They don't have blue shirts. They don't have Geek Squad. So what I would suggest, and I've worked with Hubert Joly and his team at Best Buy, and I said, listen, what you need to do is you need to own the service experience for digital technology in the home. You know, your digital concierge, the guy who's basically like, I got you, I'll install it, I'll maintain it, and you know what? Buy the stuff from Amazon, please. I don't want to be stalking televisions. You please buy them. But once the stuff comes into your house, I'm going to come in and install it. You're going to pay me $500 to program your universal remote control. You're going to pay me money for that. And by the way, I'll make a ton of money on cables and wires and so on and so on and so forth. But that's, it becomes a service business. Because if you look at what's going on with technology today, you know, maintenance, installation, warranty, upgrades, trade-in programs, rent-to-own, there are so many services that Best Buy can create. And these are privileged assets that it doesn't that Amazon doesn't have. My, you know, sort of extreme pushing this thought process further is that Best Buy becomes a service arm for Amazon, right? They merge. So that's just like, you guys do the physical, we'll do the, you know, you got the store. But then the stores will, the form factor will have to shrink because it becomes a services business. So that's the idea of, you know, asymmetric competition. That's what HBO is doing. So they're getting killed by all these guys, a lot of streaming. But what is the privileged asset they have? Content, right? Because every one of these people now are worrying about content. I got great content, so what do? I go kill my channel. And I say, hello, I'm going to offer my own streaming service. The cable company say, you're going to do what? Because I thought you were our partner. You know, I'm sorry, I got to go direct. So the HBO streaming service, the HBO Go is around. And now what we're starting to see is bundles of cord-cutting solutions. Like if there's a movie fanatic, there's a particular solution. If you're a sports fanatic, there's another way to do it. But at the end of the day, all you need is a stick. You know, Amazon Fire Stick or a, you know, Chromecast at the other end. So, or a laptop. So that's the first thing. Disrupt yourself with privileged assets, right? So here, you should only do this if your core revenue stream is under serious attack. And it is imminent. Your death is imminent. And also, if you know that the industry is eventually moving to the disruptive model. Like with Amazon and Walmart, the writing is on the wall. Customers have voted that they do want online commerce. So you're not going to be pretend that I'm putting my head in the sand, it's going to go away. And this transition is happening relatively quickly. But you need a leadership team. By the way, we talk about Netflix as a disruptor. They disrupted themselves, right? They killed their model not once but twice. They disrupted Blockbuster by doing DVD rental. Then they killed that model to going to streaming, right? And now they're moving again to original content and becoming a production studio. So, and remember what happened when they killed the DVD service. Their stock crashed, lost 80% of its value. And now, you know, if you had bought it at that time, you'd be all retired. So acquire is the next strategy. This is a little less disruptive. But here the idea is, can I import DNA? You know, I sometimes tell people that if you've got a, what is grafting? When you do graft fruit trees, I said that, you know, old roots and new shoots make great fruits, right? So you can graft some of this capability because it would take too long to build it by yourself. So that's the idea. That's what Allstate does with eSurance. And that's what Walmart's done with Jet.com. I just wrote an essay in Forbes about what is Walmart buying with Jet.com? And it's a very interesting question about what should be the end game. If the end game is that they build a digital silo and they got $5 billion of e-commerce business, that's bullshit. They just wasted their money. What they are buying, what they should be buying, is the capabilities and the leadership team, you know, and their knowledge about how to actually infuse. And if so, the end game for Walmart should be, can I infect and infuse this digital DNA that I've got from Jet.com into the core of the Walmart e-commerce operations? For that, you got to hang on to their leadership team, and you got to convince them that Arkansas is a nice place to live, right? So these are Silicon Valley type, you know, people. They don't like Bentonville. So the odds of this thing working out are fairly low, in my opinion. But it's important to understand that what they're buying is this capability that they're bringing in. Same thing with eSurance. Allstate is able to learn the direct model without the agents getting in the way in the core business. And then slowly, but ultimately your game plan has to be the following. It's a step by step. You need to isolate it. You need to incubate it at arm's length. Then you need to infiltrate it into the core business and integrate it. It's a four-step process. By the way, if you don't do these two steps, if you don't have a digital incubator, disruptive incubator of some kind, it's never going to get started. But if you don't do these two steps, you end up with a digital silo. You've got to enter. And by the way, this is like the rocket re-entering Earth, this infiltrate. That's the critical. And by the way, when do you throw the switch? These are the startup phases. This is the into the mothership. You throw this switch when you need to start scaling. when you start, and when you need to start scaling, then you need that mothership's tethers. What are the tethers of the mothership? You need the brand. You need the truck rolls and the distribution. You need capital. That's when you start to go in. So for example, there's an operation like this at AT&T. You know, Glenn Lurie ran this unit. It was called EDO, Emerging Devices Organization. So Emerging Devices Organization is a group set up within AT&T reporting to the CEO whose charter was run fast and you got no P&Ls and don't worry about the 5/9 enterprise. You know, because AT&T will test things for 10 years and get it 99.99% right while the earth has moved on. So they one case study Glenn shared with me was, you know AT&T Digital Life, their home automation and home security, came out of EDO. So EDO went and said, we need a platform for home automation. They found a company called Zanbu, startup company. They went there and said, we want to buy you. So the entrepreneur said, okay, where are your lawyers? Where's your team of people? He says, it's me. He says, just you? He says, yes. Can you make a decision? He says, yes. Who else? Nobody else. 1 week, the deal got done. The entrepreneurs almost fell off their chair saying, how can you, do you have the authority to do this thing so quickly? Then they took this, incubated it, built the AT&T Digital Life. But the moment that you are now ready to go to market, now I go to 2,400 stores. A truck roll is $180. So I got these people coming in. I have the AT&T. So I now leverage that network. I do the brand, and I get into the mainstream organization. So that's a model that I would suggest, Raj, as you work with your clients and they're worrying about how do we create a disruptive organization. It's a two-step process that you need to. And this can be done through acquisition or through creating your own central incubation unit, right? So in acquiring a disruptor, the basic question is it better to buy than build? Would it take too long, right? Do I actually don't have these capabilities and I cannot hire that talent? Also, do I have a clear path to integration, right? What am I going to do with this asset once I buy it and acquire it? And can I hang on to the talent long enough? Otherwise, I've just, given somebody a nice exit. The third is adapt. In adapt, basically what I say is that I'm actually going to change my value proposition and I'm going to expand the scope of my offering. I'm going to actually open up my platforms and APIs. I'm going to become a more open company. And I'm going to essentially increase the scope of the offering that I'm going to create. So this is really about transforming, because here what you're starting to say is that if my core business is commoditizing, can I open up a greater share of the wallet? Can I find new adjacencies to leverage? And this is what we're doing at Jio in India. So Reliance Jio was created by Mukesh Ambani, which is, it's a $50 billion petrochemicals company. So I was asking him, I said, how did you come up with this idea and the name? So he just wrote J-I-O and put it before a mirror. You know what's laterally inverted? It's oil. So it's taking the oil money and, the petrochemicals business is throwing off $10 billion a year in cash flow. So this is all internally funded, $20 billion in CapEx. There's no investors. It's all internally generated. So, but what we said is, one thing that is banned inside the company is the word telco. We are not a telco, right? It's a digital ecosystem. So it starts with 4G, LTE. It's an LTE only. There's no fallback. All voice is over LTE, VoLTE, video voice chat, 300 channels of live video, all movies on demand, payments, Jio Money. So there's a whole payment infrastructure, B2B, SMB solutions, connected home, schools, verticals, enterprises. So it's basically, think of it as Amazon plus PayPal plus AT&T plus Netflix all rolled into one. So these are some of the numbers. CapEx was 20 billion. Coverage at launch was 20,000 towns, 100,000 villages, 300,000 kilometers of fiber, 120,000 towers, nationwide spectrum, 1,000 retail centers at launch, 1.5 million retail outlets at launch. EBITDA positive in 2.5 years. All debt will be paid off in 5 years. Because why does this work? 150 million subscribers, $8 ARPU, that's 20 billion revenues, right? It's very simple. This is, actually, there's a whole essay I want to write on this, a concept of economics of extreme scale. The economics of extreme scale is the idea that instead of selling something for 100 bucks a person to 1 million people, what happens when you sell it at $1 a person to 100 million people? It's very hard to wrap your heads around that. The ARPUs in India are $3-$4 a month, right? And we're pricing our data at 50 rupees per gig. That's 70 cents per gigabyte. look at your cell phone bill to see how much a gigabyte costs you. So, but yet it'll make money. It'll make money because we're going to generate today already the data traffic on the Jio network is more than Verizon. And how long has Verizon been around? So this is completely redefining the value proposition. The last thing is absorb. And this is where I think, by the way, you should all begin. At least do this for me, please, right? Which is digitize your enterprise. And digitizing the enterprise basically is saying, I'm going to look at my business processes end to end. I'm going to look at my customer experience across channels. I'm going to look at, particularly, by the way, the frontier to me is the front office. Because your social experience, your digital experience, as you go through all these social channels is fragmented. It's a mess, and it's only going to get worse. So that's where what we're going to see. So this sort of leads to the social experience management, and I want to just a few words on technology here. So this is the 1.0 customer engagement model, right? So you have your brand, and you have your front office functions, sales, e-commerce, marketing, care, research, product development, and so on. And then you had these traditional touch points. These are all the print, phone, television, call center, radio, and display. So that was, life was good. We were doing our mass media, mass marketing, okay? And so that's your 1.0 model. Then what happens is 2.0. Now, suddenly what we start to see is, wait a minute, I have all this other stuff now. And when I last counted, there are 26 social channels I counted, right? So what do? We don't change this. But what we start to do is we start to send out our marketing communications through all these. We now have a mobile team, we have a social team, we have a digital team. We still have the traditional marketing team is still doing network commercial. They're like, don't mess with us. Take petty cash and do your digital stuff, but don't. So we've created this 2.0 engagement model. So this is sort of, channels of engagement changed, but nothing inside the organization changed. And I'm using a legacy organization and a functional silos, and I'm going to try to push my content through all of these channels. This model, as you can see, is unworkable, right? So what you have now is a whole bunch of channel-specific and function-specific systems. So you started to invest in point solutions in each of these. You have your social listening tool, you have your CRM tool, you have whatever, you have the marketing cloud, you have, so there's a whole bunch of, if some of the larger companies in the room, if you do an audit, you might have anywhere from 20 to 50 vendors that you're working with in this space. So all that is good, but this is chaos. This is chaos, and it's only going to get. And what does it affect? It affects the customer, because now my journey, So what we need, the problem is here. Let me explain this in terms of permutations. Social is many channels, right? But you also have many functions. So there's content planning, campaign management, publishing, engagement, CRM, reporting, governance, and then you cross this with all the social channels, and you've got the permutation and combination problem. Like, so there's a 10 functions times, 20 different or 30 different channels. So that's the mess that we are in, and this is starting to break down. So this is, so then we said, let's go social. So we buy all the stuff, right? This is the LumaScape. And now it's like, how am I going to make sense of all of this, right? So that's when you call Raj's company. So the point is that you have many point solutions. This is a categorization, publishing, listening, compliance, analytics, UGC, advocacy, commerce, command center, content marketing, advertising, communities, and so on and so forth. What you need is something to stitch this all together, right? So this is sort of really, so what we need is a unified system of engagement that gets rid of all of this silos at this layer, right? So this is, this is one point of view, by the way. There are many different ways of thinking about this. So these are the people I've been working with closely. This is Sprinklr. This is one of the companies that is in this space. I think they have the most complete vision. I'm not pushing a particular vendor. I'm just saying I like this model. So the idea is, just like you have an SOR, a system of record, you need an SOE. You need a system of engagement. A system of engagement is nothing but a system of record for your front office, which really combines and creates a, and what did SAP do for us? What did ERP do for us? It created a unified system of record, and then you could hook all the application to it. So similarly here, if you have your existing technology ecosystem, by the way, this is your CRM, your ERP stuff, and Salesforce and so on, and an API connector, that's gonna now connect to all these other functions in the front office, conversation, community, collaboration, campaign, you know, and content management. So you will have these modules in social experience management that all get hooked to a common bus, a common platform. So this is where one needs to go if you're going to make sense of it all, right? So we've seen this movie before. What we had with supply chain was essentially a unified product ID that allowed us to track everything. In fact, one of the humorous discussions I had with my student who used to work for StrideRite, they were in the sneaker business, this was 15 years ago, and he said that they tried to do SAP implementation and they could not do it because the SKU in a shoe is two-dimensional, 9 wide. And SAP says, I'm sorry, we only do one-dimensional SKUs. So this reminds me of the cobbler I went to in India where I said, you know, make me a shoe. He's like, you know, what's your shoe size? I said, 8.5. He says, I have 8 and I have 9. So just, you know, wear the 8, your foot will adjust, you know? So that's SAP, you know, it's like, you know, your enterprise will adjust. Yes, you know, this is the way we do it, so we don't do two-dimensional SKUs. So anyway, but it was all good, right? This was what, then what we had was the back office. This is more recently what's starting to happen with companies like Workday, where you have a unified employee ID, and you're able to track them through. So now what we need is for the front office, we need a customer ID that's gonna track you through the whole front office. So this is the holy grail, and eventually, by the way, initially this is gonna start with digital and social, but slowly you're going to now weave the other channels. It's still not fast, the holy grail is you're tracking a unified customer ID through all the traditional media. But the fundamental shift now is that digital should become your center of gravity, and then think about how the other channels fit in, as opposed to the other way around where digital was an add-on and you're still doing your traditional media. So in conclusion, the capabilities that you need to invest in, I was glad that Raj showed, you know, the chief digital officer, digital board member. I mean, I have a simple, so I have this naive hypothesis. It's anecdotal, but help me see if it resonates with you. If you are trying to build capability in an organization where you have, where you're nascent in that capability, and there are pockets of excellence, but the enterprise as a whole has not been able to adopt, I think it is very important to concentrate the capability into a center of excellence that's centralized. Conversely, as you build more of this capability in the enterprise and you start to push this capability into the business units, you need to kill the center of excellence. This is what we did 15 years ago by creating e-commerce units. And this is what we need to do with CDOs and digital centers of excellence. This is what you need to do with innovation. You need a central innovation unit when you don't have innovation DNA. But when I went to eBay 10 years ago, I said, where's your innovation department? They're like, are you kidding me? Everybody here does innovation. We don't have an innovation officer. So when the day everybody does digital, we will not need chief digital officers. So, you know, I wrote an article sometime back where I said, long live the innovation department, kill the innovation department. So I apply the same thing to digital. Long live the CDO, kill the CDO. But you need them in the short run because you need, it's a crutch. But when you start to run, then eventually you're going to diffuse this. But today it is urgent that you create a center of excellence, concentrate the capability, because it gives you one place. That digital center of excellence will do a few things. One is it'll standardize platforms and tools because you have like a wild, wild west. The second thing it'll do is it'll invest in capability development for employees. The third thing that it does is it corrals the best practices and the experiments that you're going on, both internal and external, in one place. So those are the, and the fourth thing it does is acts as a service provider to the business units as they get up to speed. But eventually, it gets diffused. So that's kind of the idea of the digital center of excellence. And similarly, creating a lab, a digital innovation lab. And I think that this is, one thing, I was with Red Hat 2 weeks ago in New York. They've done something fascinating. They've created the Open Innovation Lab. When the Open Innovation Lab, what they do is they actually work with clients and customers, and they work together to actually incubate ideas. So it's basically like an outsourced or crowdsourced or co-sourced incubation and innovation unit that's in deep partnership with their customers. Because the customers find they can't move fast enough, and they're actually advising Red Hat on where their technology stack needs to go with microservices, containers, and all the stuff that they're working on. So this sort of close partnership with your service providers, vendors. In fact, a suggestion I might have for Brillio is to actually create these innovation labs where you become sort of an extension of your client's incubation and innovation capability, because they are, you know, they can't move as fast as you're able to do. So that's going to be, you know, something too. So these are some of the capabilities that I think that you need to invest in. So, at the end of the day, to lead digital enablement, this is not a middle management initiative. This is top down. It's an enterprise-wide view. You need to embrace a whole bunch of other things like agile, you know, as well as creating governance. And governance today, you know, I'm going to be working with next month with AbbVie. You know, they're a pharma company. The definition of governance is we can't do anything in social media because the FDA won't allow it. You know, and so when you go to the website of AbbVie today, their number one drug is Humira for rheumatoid arthritis. The first thing you see on the web page is side effects, right? And this is what you don't do. This is how it's going to kill you, and so on. There is no content. There is no content on their website. And then I went to another website, which I want you to check out if you know anybody who's afflicted by this ailment. It's called RA Warrior, Rheumatoid Arthritis Warrior. A woman called Kelly Young personally started this website. It is so deep, thousands of pages of content, stories, videos, resources, and she doesn't worry about the FDA. You know, because people sharing stories about living with rheumatoid arthritis. I'm like, AbbVie, why don't you have these stories on your website? But now we're talking about governance. You know, so governance can be a police or it can be an enabler. So that's how you really have to think. And then, of course, talent, data capabilities, analytics capabilities, UI, UX design capabilities. And in the short run, it absolutely, you need to import these capabilities. And that's where partnerships with companies like Brillio become so important, because you will, you know what the chief scientist of Sun used to tell me? He says, the smartest people don't work for you. Right, so that's why partnerships are important in this journey. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Okay, thank you. Well, I don't know how we're doing on time. If you have a couple of minutes for questions, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, sorry, I went a mile a minute, but you know, that's. Yes. There are some other frictions, and those frictions will emerge more from regulation, and you know, and other questions like labor rights, and you know, so it's not that nirvana, because what we are also finding now is there's a lot of pushback. So if it becomes employment, then are you a W-2 employee? Are you 1099? How does it all work? So there are some issues then, and also institutions will push back. So Uber is banned in Germany and Spain and so on. So, but theoretically the answer is yes, but the Nobel was just given to people in contract theory, right? There are always transaction costs. Because what we are moving, ultimately, and I'm now echoing what Holmstrom and these guys and have been talking about course, we're moving from hierarchies to markets, right? The different governance mechanisms of organizing an economy. But in a market, so in what we do in a hierarchy is we use command and control as a coordination mechanism. In a market, we use contracts. And contracts always have transaction costs. There's imperfect information, there's hazard, moral hazard. So there are, that's what will prevent the perfect elasticity. But generally speaking, the shift from hierarchies to markets is a secular shift. That's where we're going. Yeah, I, you know, when I say education, it's a big space, so I have to sort of segment it by, first of all, degree education versus lifelong learning. And then degree education, again, is everything from elementary to high school to professional education. So I can talk about disruption in different, you know, layers. There's lots of different layers. But let's take something that's close to my heart, which is how do business schools operate, right? So in the world of business school, we are setting ourselves up for disruption because we are pricing ourselves out of the market. An executive MBA at Kellogg costs you $180,000. That is criminal, right? And it is because we have this sort of whole bunch of orthodoxies about how we teach executives. We just built a, and thank you if you did contribute, alumni, you know, a $350 million new building on the lake, you know, and we're moving in January. And I'm like, is this a testament to yesterday's management education? It's like, I mean, don't get me wrong, we need physical plant and stuff. But what we need essentially to solve this trade-off between richness and reach in executive education. And I think the disruption is going to come more from the shorter non-degree programs because we still have this degree granting status and the value of the alumni network. But if I want to just go in and learn the latest in business marketing or the latest in digital, why do I need to, like, you know, come there? If I can create, particularly if I can create some aspects of the social experience, use technology either to scale or to provide location independence, then we can create some disruptive models. And this disruption is therefore going to come from potentially from the third parties. You're seeing the edges of this, you know, the Khan Academies of the world and the other sort of, but it's not going to come for the core MBA program, but eventually we're going to have to figure out a way to scale our executive education. I mean, MOOC is one instance of this, but I don't think the model is done right. I'm doing an experiment right now, which I think is much closer to where it needs to be. I'm doing a private MOOC. Think of MOOC as a public cloud. I'm doing a private cloud. This is with Microsoft. We're doing a MOOC for their marketing community. But now the problem with MOOC is compliance, right? I don't take the course. I take one lecture. Who the hell cares? But I can enforce that inside a company. So we're doing a private MOOC for 2,500 of their marketing people. I think that may be an example of how executive education might go in the future. But again, you know, we got to disrupt ourselves before somebody else comes up and does this.